So good morning again. Thanks everyone for tuning in to the second edition of Beyond the Frame with me, Rebecca Rao of MS Rao in New Orleans. This is our second episode. I'll be here all month in June, and this week I'm talking about who influenced who in the art world. So it's essentially a who's who of the art world, but rather than talking about artists of today, we'll be focusing mostly on artists of the 19th century. So yes, most of them are deceased. In fact, they're all deceased. But they still led really fascinating lives, and I wanted to share a little bit about those with you. So diving right in, I wanted to start by talking about Camille Corot. He's the quintessential Barbizon painter. He's a really interesting 19th century seminal character because he sort of acts as a transitional artist. What I mean by that is he was really academically trained, and he participated in the state-sanctioned salons of Paris. But that being said, he ended up ultimately really going on to influence the Impressionist painters. And as this Barbizon school painter, he really prized being able to connect directly with nature. And you see that in this amazing picture. So he's out there with his easel, he's painting en plein air. That means he's working live from a landscape. And I just love how cool he looks with this great painter's smock and his pipe. So we took a look at this painting last week, but here's an example of a landscape he painted while working in the Fontainebleau forest and out with the Barbizon painters. And you see that he really looks at the way light is affecting the landscape and what the feelings that the landscape evoked from him. He went on to influence so many of the Impressionists, but another key figure and kind of proto-Impressionist I wanted to highlight was Camille Pissarro. So I just love looking at these paintings back to back. They have a really similar color palette. Both have these nice, rich, earthy hues, these muddy hues. And the style is kind of similar. Maybe Pissarro is getting a little bit looser, a little bit more impressionistic, but you can certainly see Corot's influence on Pissarro. As I mentioned, Corot influenced so many of the Impressionists, and Monet famously said, "There is only one master here, Corot. We are nothing by comparison." But Pissarro is interesting because he's also a bit of a transitional artist. He worked for 10 years with post-Impressionist artist Cézanne and Gauguin, and so he kind of fits the mold of that. He's an early proto-Impressionist, but then over the course of his lifetime begins working in a more post-Impressionist style where he starts integrating these beautiful expressive colors. You get a sense of the dynamism and movement of the figures in the field, and I just really love this painting that we had as that was an earlier part of our collection here at MS Rao. Now, Camille Pissarro is interesting for so many reasons, but one of them is that he produced a legacy of artists within his family. So he's kind of the figurehead of the family, but his son Paul-Emile was also a painter in his own right. We have had a number of his canvases here at MS Rao. But even more commonly, we see the work of his grandson, Hugh Claude Pissarro. Now, Hugh Claude is still alive and working today. He's in his 80s. He produces beautiful paintings, but what we often see are his pastels, really detailed, really interesting. He trained at a couple of écoles in Paris, but nonetheless, you still see that early Impressionist and post-Impressionist influence kind of moving down the family line into H. Claude's work. So, funnily enough, I had the pleasure of meeting Camille's great-granddaughter, who's also a painter. She's an English artist working out of New York, and she visited our gallery recently, and she told me that it was an unoriginal line of work for her to be in as a painter, and I had to chuckle because obviously I am a fourth-generation fine art dealer, so I certainly relate on the other side of the spectrum. Moving right along, I wanted to talk about Jean-Léon Gérôme's influence on Mary Cassatt. Jean-Léon Gérôme is another really highly influential artist, both for his amazing body of work. He's sort of the quintessential Orientalist painter, working in a natural and realist style, highly talented, but also because he taught at the École des Beaux-Arts. So a lot of artists whose names you'll know today were students of his. One I wanted to focus on is Mary Cassatt. Now, she came from a well-to-do Pennsylvania family, so money was not the, so she had resources behind her, but her family was reluctant for her to enter such a male-dominated field. Funny how things change over time. This is a common thread. Anyway, Mary Cassatt had the pleasure of being taken in for private lessons rather than attending his classes at the École des Beaux-Arts, he took her in as a private pupil. So Gérôme kind of famously snubbed the Impressionists. He while exhibiting widely and over the course of his career in the Salon, he made it clear that the style of the Impressionism he looked down upon. But I think you could really argue, and if you've ever taken a look at Mary Cassatt's works on paper, you'll know that she had a real talent for draftsmanship. She knew how to draw. She understood the underlying technicalities of drawing and painting, even though she ultimately went to work in this more loose, expressive style. So here's a work from our current collection of Jean-Léon Gérôme's. It's just What I think the artist shares is a sense of intimacy. You kind of really feel like a peek behind the scenes. Here's the Turkish hammams and this amazing guard whose uniform just makes me smile. I love his curled slippers, if you take a look at his toes there. But then if you compare that to another kind of yellow-tinted painting by Marie Cassatt, again, it's a very sweet scene between mother and child. Both of these, again, feel like a peek behind the scenes. Something interesting you might know about Jerome is that, while we're sharing personal tidbits, is that he very wisely married into the Goupil family. That's of Goupil AC, a really prominent Parisian dealership. So while his works were, he was selling well in the 1860s, 70s, 80s, his works were selling for tens and hundreds of times of the amounts of money that his Impressionist contemporaries were. So here's an artist that was really beloved in his time, while some of his students and protégés might have been a little more controversial and took time to be appreciated on the market. All right. And hats off to Marie Cassatt for breaking into the art market as an American female. She clearly had the talent for it. Next up is Claude Monet and Blanche Hochelet-Monet. You're very familiar with Claude's life, so I'm mostly going to focus on the relationship between the two. It's very interesting and convoluted. But first, here's photos of the two of them at different periods of time in Claude's studio in Giverny. Blanche is Claude Monet's daughter-in-law and stepdaughter. So her family moved in with the Monets when she was a child after her father went bankrupt, but their lives became very intertwined. She went on to marry Claude's son Jean, and then later in his life, Claude went on to marry Blanche's mother. So it's a little bit complicated, but certainly rich. He famously didn't appreciate anyone around watching him paint or participating in his painting, but she was an exception. She really acted as his muse, and she showed an interest in painting starting at the age of 11. He really held her accountable for developing her skills. That's both while he was living with her, but then at phases of her life when she wasn't working side by side with Monet. You just see their lives are very intertwined. He famously had cataracts later in life, and some art historians hypothesize that she might have in fact finished works of his while he was caring for her. So that brings up on the market side, it brings up issues of value and authenticity that are very interesting. But as you can see, she's an artist in her own right. First, I'll show you a work in our current collection by Claude, this nice valley scene with beautiful kind of dense, rich light. And then take a look at this cliffside landscape by Blanche Hochelet-Monet. So it's just at the same time period, but we both see these really violet hills. And just compositionally, stylistically, they're so similar. It's really fascinating. So shout out to Blanche for being an unsung hero of the Monet family. Let's see, moving right along. Next, I'll talk about Sir Lawrence Almatadema and John William Godward. So Sir Lawrence Almatadema is kind of the preeminent Victorian painter. He's actually Dutch and was trained in the Netherlands, but he then came over to England was very well received, very beloved in his lifetime. Interestingly enough, like many of these more romantic painters, his work went out of fashion for a number of decades after his death. He actually died in 1912, which is the year M.S. Rao was founded. So just a neat tidbit that kind of speaks to me and how the cycles of art history work. Anyway, Almatadema painted these immersive, beautiful, expressive, romantic, classical scenes. He loved to imagine the past. And his influence extends into the future, largely in the way of his influence on Hollywood. So Almatadema's his paintings directly influence both the costumes and the sets of films that you've probably seen, like The Ten Commandments, Cleopatra, Gladiator, Ben-Hur, and others. Now, here's a good example. This painting is entitled The Finding of Moses. You've probably seen it. That's because it's the most expensive Victorian painter ever sold at auction. This went for $36 million in 2010. So even though he went out of fashion for a bit in the early 20th century, he is back, people love them, and he influenced a lot of artists of his generation and the following. One such artist is John William Godward, English neoclassical painter who I love. Equally romantic, equally in love with the past. You can clearly see the influence in his technical ability. So Godward and his contemporaries are sometimes referred to as the marble school. That's because of their ability to render texture. I mean, you can just imagine the coolness coming from that marble on a hot summer day. So Godward painted these Italian looking women. He famously ran off to Italy with one of them for a period of time. And he is also known for his tendency to paint models in the nude and then very delicately apply their clothing on top. So you could see these diaphanous robes. Much like some of the other artists I've mentioned, Godward's family was not so fond of the idea of him becoming an artist. They really shunned this idea. And sadly, we don't know a ton of details about his personal life. And that's due to the fact that after he committed suicide, his family burned all of his personal belongings. However, a juicy tidbit that I really find endearing is allegedly his suicide note included the statement that there was not space in a world for, there was not room in the world for a Godward alongside a Pablo Picasso. So earlier in Picasso's career, he's really pushing the art world forward, creating room for modernism, and someone who was just so taken with the past, this romantic past that he idealized, just couldn't stand to be alive in a world with a Picasso. I just love that and think it's really fascinating, that contrast. Now, I'm sure you know plenty about Picasso's life because he's been quite the topic of conversation over the last few years, but I just thought I'd share this, I thought I'd end on this great presumed self-portrait by the famous artist to get you thinking about all of these artists and their influence on the 20th century. So thank you so much for tuning in. Again, I'm Rebecca Rao. This is our Beyond the Frame Instagram live series. This is week 2 of 5. I'll be here all June at 10 a.m. and I hope you will tune in. Feel free to reach out to me directly with questions. My Instagram handle is the 4th Rao. Hope to see y'all next week.